Hello everyone, welcome to yet another show on Sakshi Apologetics Network on Refuting Rajiv Malhotra and Kamakshi Dhanraj. It looks like the second video of 7 minutes probably, she made a lot of allegations against Christians and she talked about starting a blog or maybe producing series of videos about quitting Christianity. And it's one thing to leave Christian faith, and it's another thing. It's altogether a different provocation to talk about helping people to quit Christianity. So we will talk a little bit about all of that. With George this evening. Hi, George. Welcome.
Hi, Praveen.
So George is the one. I mean, let me introduce George a little bit. George is the one. George and Jerry were the ones that started Sakshi Apologetics Network, along with a lot of us who were in different states of India, about 10 states now, approximately 10 states now. We are working, and we started way back in 2006 at Refuting Islam and things like love jihad and things like grooming girls and things like challenging the divinity of Jesus Christ, etc., etc. And at that time, from that time onwards, George and others have been very instrumental in bringing the strongholds down for the kingdom of God. So to begin with, what do you think about that video, George? I'm sure you have watched that video.
Yes, I watched that video, Praveen. As usual, she has been making allegations. It was just allegations without any proof. She hasn't named anyone who shamed her. Or, she has just, in fact, if you compare what she has spoken in this video and the previous video, we can surely say that even here she has contradicted herself. In the previous video, she mentioned that they were praying for her. And in this video, she says that people are shaming her.
So what do you mean by shaming, like by family and friends? Do you really see that practice in Christianity, or is it true even in the other side as well? Of course, it is true even in the other side of the other sides of the faith. For example, Hindus and Muslims and etc. Like apostasy in Islam,
yeah,
and apostasy in Hinduism. We have witnessed, yeah, that for thousands of years in India. We know that people who have who did not follow the Sanatana Dharma have been vandalized, have been brutally killed, sometimes brutally accused of so many things in this land. Yeah. And compared to that, family, asking questions about her faith and what made her give up her faith, is that really shaming her, or how do you look at it?
In fact, I would say that, as I already mentioned, in a previous video, she says that, people were praying for her and they communicated to her that she would come back and that they are confident that she would come back. But she made categorical statement saying that she's not going to come back. But still people communicated to her and said that they are praying for her. This is not shaming. This is out of concern that they are praying. Mm-hmm. And she should be happy to know that people are concerned about her. Mm-hmm. These people would pray even for her other needs. If she says these are the needs that she has, mm-hmm, they would not hesitate to pray. Mm-hmm. This is out of concern that they are praying. Mm-hmm. And, she may think that they are not intellectually sound as she claims to be right now, but in spite of all that, these people are concerned for her, and that's why they pray. Christians pray out of concern, not to shame or put down anybody. And in fact, if you look at what she has been claiming in a previous video, if you watch that, and her practice as a young child, before she came to Christianity, when she was in Hinduism, that was shaming. In fact, they were asked to change clothes before they entered the house. That was shaming the Dalits or Muslims or Christians, whomever they used to play. That was shaming them as untouchables. And that was actually shaming, where, actually the practice was because they played with somebody that, they had to change the clothes. That is communicating and practicing untouchability to an extent.
So you think she actually went back to the culture of shame and honor from the culture of truth and lie. So because she was exposed to so-called truth that she claims, she left the truth and went to the shame and honor culture because she already practiced it in her past.
You know, I don't know where she went. I can't comment on her internal state. But what I
well, there is a question here. I mean, when she is when she went back, she didn't go to a agnostic forum. She didn't go to a atheist forum. She went to a Hindutva goon forum. She went to a forum which divides India. She went to a forum, you know, that raises money in the name of Infinity Foundation to divide India, to fund universities, to profile hardworking, you know, Indologists and, you know, support Indologists of their ideology and support Indologists of breaking India concept. So that's the reason I'm asking you about this.
When it comes to her internal state, I'm not sure about that. But when it come, when as a practice, what she has, she is doing, because the scripture asks us to test and, you know, analyze people based on the practice or based by the actions that they do, based on the actions that they do. So from her actions, she is actually communicating that she is in favor of people who oppress, who beat up Christians, who, you know, who are oppressive and, you know, who wants to, want to take India in a regressive way, you know, maybe 5,000 years or, you know, 10,000 years back. So she's in support of that, those kinds of people. Recently, you know, as you know, Karnakar and some of his people poured water mixed with cow dung on a few people who were distributing tracts. So she supports those actions. You know, if she has gone and, you know, is friendly with them, she supports those actions. She hasn't come out criticizing those actions, but she speaks so openly about people shaming her. In fact, they haven't shamed her.
Well, she also posted a couple of posts on the Facebook saying that Sanatana Dharma is the best form of religion, if given an, given fair analysis. And I mean, this is I'm putting it in my own paraphrasing language. But her you know, her inclination definitely is towards these funders of the criminality within India. And so I think I certainly am sure positive that she is definitely after that kind of mob who are trying to divide India and who are trying to spread hatred against Christians and Christianity and profile the Christian faith. Anyways, coming to the second part, you know, another question, she says that anybody that questions Christianity are profiled, and they say, you know, you do not have good relationship with Jesus, or you have you are influenced by Satan, you know, etc., etc. And also she says, you know, whoever is asking, whoever is thinking about Christianity, and I believe in Christ, but, and the moment somebody says but, she wants to encourage them by having this blog or maybe a website called Christianity. How do you see this? I mean, are you afraid? Are you kind of baffled with this kind of statement? And are you, are your young people and are your you know, church members very afraid of this kind of movement?
In fact, I want her to I would personally want her to start the blog so that it would be an opportunity to preach Christ more. And, you know, if she asks real intellectual questions, it would be an opportunity to answer her and promote and preach the Christian faith to people who are seeking. And many people may have the same questions of who are not in the fold of Christianity or who are not following Jesus. They may have the same questions, and by answering those questions, we would be, you know, helping people who are seeking to come to know Jesus and to follow Jesus. So we are not afraid of her questions. In fact, we want her to start. We want
well,
her to...
you know, we have witnessed for the past 2 years, she's been saying that we will question, we'll question, we'll question, and we haven't seen any, you know, any series of videos, any serious content, you know, given out. It was all just some, you know, just vain words. Anyways, so coming back to the question again, you know, Rajiv Malhotra also says, like, you know, freedom to question is important. And because she's got freedom to question, she's profiled and stuff like that. Do you think from his ideology, Hindutva ideology, is he of the, I mean, can we understand that Rajiv Malhotra supports questioning, I mean, freedom to question?
I don't think so. Before answering that question about Rajiv Malhotra, I would like to ask, you know, I think I missed out on one of the questions that you asked me about, she mentioning that, you know, if someone questions in Christianity, they are called as, not following Jesus sincerely, or, because they are not following Jesus sincerely, Satan has entered their life and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. Maybe she faced, such questioning or such kind of things were mentioned to her, when she was following Jesus, or, you know, when she claimed to have followed Jesus.
Mm.
What I would say is, there may be few people like that, or, you know, there may be many people in Christianity like that, but Christianity, that doesn't mean Christianity is not an intellectual faith. That doesn't mean that there aren't people who study the Christian faith from an intellectual angle. In fact, I am the one who asked so many questions even before I was saved. And I was saved, I started following Jesus because of questions.
Now give me a break. Your name is George and you have been a Christian right from your birth, right?
That's what people think, that, if my name is George, I'm a follower of Jesus right from my birth. But that's not true. That's not what the scriptural stand, biblical stand is also. Someone should follow Jesus on their own will. They should decide to follow Jesus. That's when, they become Christians. That, because even in scriptures, the follower of Jesus were called Christians.
Mm.
That's what the Bible says.
Mm.
So there is a starting point for anyone, any follower of Jesus. He starts at one particular point in his life. Nobody is a born Christian.
So when we're coming back to the freedom of questioning, if you question your authorities in Christianity, are they profiled? Are they like, you know, discriminated or set, you know, or looked at as an apostate?
In fact, I would totally disagree with that, because the history of the church, if we study, and she claims to have studied the church history, I don't know how much she studied. The history of the church has been a history of questioning. Martin Luther, whom she mentioned before, was the one who questioned the Catholic Church. In fact, he nailed his 99 Theses, and that's how he quit the Catholic Church, and he started a reformation within the Christian faith. So, you know, and before Martin Luther, there were many people. John Huss was one of them, and there were many doctrinal debates within the church. And if you study the doctrinal debates, it was a faith of questioning. And I don't know from where she got this kind of history where you shouldn't question. If you are questioned, you are called as if your Satan is influencing you and stuff like that. I don't know. You know, Rajiv Malhotra claiming to be an intellectual agrees with her and says, goes with her saying, that means, Satan, you have become someone belonging to Satan and things like that. That is so childish of Rajiv Malhotra to speak like that. If he has studied church history, he should know there was Augustine who debate, there was debates that went on with Augustine on the sovereignty of God and many things like that.
Mm.
The church is ridden with people who have asked questions, and those questions were debated.
Mm. So do you think the church of the Indian church is ready to handle such questions? Because they are of the opinion, I mean, Rajiv is of the opinion that Indian Christians are, they very seldom give a thought about religion, and they are not really thinkers kind of Christians.
I would totally disagree with that even, because, one of the person that I would mention from an Indian context is, this person wouldn't be known even to Rajiv, I think. I don't know if he knows. And I'm sure that Kamakshi wouldn't know this person. And in the past, let's say, 80 or 100 years, 100 and more years ago, there was a person by name K.V. Simon in Kerala. He used to debate with people in Sanskrit.
Mm.
And he was known as Mahakavi K.V. Simon. And he debated so many Hindus. And nobody could stand him. And this is the history of the Indian church too, that there were people who were debating Hindus and even other religious people. This is the history of the Indian church. Indian church wasn't anti-intellectual as such. But you know, what I would point out here is the experience of Kamakshi as she started following Jesus, as she claims she followed Jesus in the past. Her experience is of emotionalism. She didn't have any experience of intellectual study as she followed Jesus
so in the past. So for the first time, she's exposed to an intellectual, inquisitive approach. And there, she didn't follow through a mentor or somebody that can help her understand these things. But all of a sudden, when she's exposed to those things while she's going through a lot of turmoil in her own life, in fact, and that's when probably she turned a blind eye to the truth, is what you're trying to say?
From her own testimony, she was exposed to questioning, or the questions that were asked in the Christian faith by people who were agnostic or atheist or from wherever they come from, whichever kind of belief they come from. She experienced those kind of questions when she went to US, and particularly when she went to a theological college. And theological college, they study these questions, as it was mentioned by Sai Krishna Gomatam also, that he himself studied these questions, and these questions didn't take him back to his Hindu fold, or it didn't make him quit his belief in Jesus. But he studied more rigorously, which he should have done, which he failed to do. And when she speaks, we can understand the shallowness that she has. Because even here, she tries to paint it with a broad brush. Her experience in India was just emotional belief
probably
in the Christian faith. And she took that to US. And, over there, she encountered questions which were asked against Christian faith. And, she left Christianity. That's what her experience is. Because of that, she paints with a broad brush, saying all Indians are like this. And then, Rajiv Malhotra parrots the same thing along with her, saying at least in US, Christians are a bit intellectual and all that. Rajiv Malhotra being a researcher
he's a fake scholar in my opinion.
I'm giving him a benefit of doubt because
we can debate on that. Actually,
he claims to be that way. So if he really knows, he should know Mahakavi K.V. Simon, and he can Kerala Christian history.
He knows only how to break India, George. The only thing he knows, George, is how to break India.
Yeah, I totally agree with that. That, with his ideology of Manu, if someone follows the ideology of Manu, they can't but break everything. In fact, divide and rule was the ideology of Manu, not of the British.
Absolutely.
In fact, British just allowed the status quo to exist in India. Because that's what the status quo was. When the British came in, it was the Manu's law that was followed in
can't
India.
Can't agree more than that.
It was Manu's law that was followed, and British allowed and maintained that status quo. They didn't change it. Now what these people who follow Manu, what they do is they try to brush it on the British, saying they invented it. But if you study the British rule in any other part of the world, they didn't follow divide and rule.
So you're saying that the divide and rule policy is what Rajiv is trying to employ even in this case. However, let me come to, a couple of weeks ago, we have seen Delhi elections in India, and for the chief minister post of Delhi and some MLAs in Delhi. And there have been a lot of religionizing of the politics in India. We have seen people shouting chants like, Desh ke gaddaron ko goli maro salon ko. I mean, kill those who are the traitors of India. And in their opinion, traitors of India are those who left Hinduism or who are not practicing practicing of Hindutva. But in the same party which Rajiv Malhotra raises money for from India, from US and other parts of the world to break India and to bring that Hindutva Raj, Hindutva rule, he says Hindus should help human beings to be on their own, even if they are, agnostic. So, for example, in India, most of these, political leaders that are fighting against the so-called Hindutva goons are agnostic. They don't believe in a particular, absolute truth of religion. They just follow. They are agnostic. Some of them are agnostic. Some of them are atheistic. And for them, these guys say to kill them openly. And with another mouth, he says, we should help. How do you look at it? I mean, especially those who are in US, the audience in US, how should they understand these hypocrite statements?
In fact, when Rajiv Malhotra says that the freedom of religion should be there and people should be allowed to believe whatever they want, and he says Hindus should help people who are coming out of Christianity, even if they don't join the Hindu fold, and if they want to be agnostic, that's absolutely fine. Hindus should come forward to help them and all that. When he's speaking that language, I would say that, it is only applicable to people, he would particularly apply this to people who come out of Christianity and Islam. But if people want to come out of Hinduism, he would have a very different standard. He would say, beat them up, maybe. He would not allow such freedom. If he allows such freedom, he hasn't spoken anywhere. He hasn't condemned attacks on Christians in India. He hasn't condemned violence on Christians and Muslims in India. He hasn't spoken out openly, as he is doing right now, against Christians and Muslims. Moreover, when he advocates freedom to Hindus, he advocates Hindus should come forward to help people who come out of Christianity and Islam. I would say, and when he speaks about freedom, I would ask, would he give freedom to Kanhaiya Kumar, who's opposing Manu's Hinduism? Kanhaiya Kumar is primarily opposing Manu's Hinduism.
Mm.
He's not opposing Hindus as such.
Right. Yeah.
Because he himself says that he comes from a Hindu background. Mm. He comes from a place where, Krishna is worshipped and things like that. But
his name is Krishna.
Yeah.
Kanhaiya is Krishna.
Yeah. So, people like Rajiv Malhotra, wouldn't support a person like Kanhaiya Kumar because, he is, for them, he is opposing, Hinduism as such. But Kanhaiya is not opposing Hinduism. He is opposing the Manu's Hinduism, which is divide India into segments and make people backward, make people slaves for the Brahmanical religion.
Mm.
So, Rajiv wouldn't speak out openly against all those, social issues.
So, do you think his approach is very hypocritical in that nature?
Absolutely, because even when Kamakshi spoke that there's practiced untouchability when she was small, before coming out of Hinduism and before becoming Christians, that as a family they practiced untouchability, Rajiv didn't go ahead and say, as Hindus, we shouldn't be doing that. He didn't speak anything like that. He himself supports it, I think. And I think he's absolutely fine with such practice where, Hindus would change clothes if they interact with Christians, Muslims or Dalits. So, he hasn't come out and spoken very clearly condemning such action that a Brahmin or a Hindu shouldn't do that.
Well, I think it's too much of an expectation from Rajiv Malhotra to condemn such practices, because he is a Hindutva guy and he is a Hindutva goon who raises money, who raises Infinity, in the name of Infinity Foundation, he raises money to spread the casteism, to spread the inhumane practices in Hindutva, to spread the hatred among human beings within the Indian subcontinent. And of course, as George, you were saying that, they took it from here to America when it comes to, but I think people like Rajiv Malhotra are taking the Hindutva ideology even to US, because because they conducted another another conference in US to claim US with Hindutva, or to saffronize America, to saffronize America. And here they talk about not spreading any other religion. Hindutva is the Sanatana Dharma, and we don't convert people, and etc., etc. But how hypocrisy, what kind of hypocrisy is this? Yogi Adityanath went and spoke in that conference where they spoke about saffronizing America. What do you think about that, George?
In fact, Ambedkar spoke very clearly about this in his book, where he said that this Brahmanical religion is not only a menace in India, but when these people go out and settle in other nations, they would become a menace there as well. They would start implementing their caste system. They would follow the divide and rule policy even there. Rajiv Malhotra, when he worked for software companies and all that, would have entertained primarily only Brahmins and, people like that. And he would have profiled people and hired only certain kind of people. And these people, it is there in their blood, at least for few people who are out and out sold out for the Manu's religion, like Rajiv Malhotra. They are like that. I don't know where, only the light of Christ can transform them, where, the scripture says there is neither Jew, there is neither male nor female. There is no difference as such. All are equal in the sight of God. Only scripture and the Bible can give them that equality, because God, when he created the male and female, created them equally as human beings. But their scriptures is very clear, where it says that, Brahma created inequality in society, and that is sociologically they implement it sociologically, and that's what these people are promoting as a government, as a religion, as everything, and even from his organization.
Right. So well, this is a pretty good, this has been a pretty good talk, George. But let us give a fair invitation to people of America, people who live in Europe, people who live in India, who are who wants to who support secular ideas, who support whether it is Hindu, whether it is Christian, whether it is Islam, whoever they are, let them be questioned and let them be exposed to questions, and let us give a fair a chance to question. So George, what do you think about, finally, this is the final question, what do you think about quitchristianity.com, whether it is a blog post or a website? How are you going to respond to that?
In fact, I would say that she should come up with Quit Christianity as soon as possible, so that we would know the kind of questions that she has. I think that she would only have shallow questions, and she would not have intellectual provocative questions as such, where we would be able to go deep and examine. We need not even do that. We need not even go ahead and study. We can answer her questions outrightly. That's what I think her scholarship level is, where we can answer her without even much study. We are waiting for her blog to come up, so that it would be an opportunity for us Christians to promote our faith. And this is what the church history has been. People have asked us questions, and we have responded. We haven't gone out to critique others first, but people have critiqued us first, and we have responded to them and in answering their questions.
Right.
So this has been the church history, if Kamakshi has studied church history in any which way. So we want to repeat what has been happening right from Jesus on. People came and asked Jesus questions. He didn't go around asking questions to people. People came and asked questions to Jesus, and Jesus responded to them. And that's how he strengthened his disciples too.
Mm.
And that's what we want to do, just like our Jesus.
Mm. So will you also come up with something, I mean, to help people, you know, to answer these questions?
I mean, we can come up with maybe a website where people can understand better what is Hindutva is. Mm. See, Hinduism is very different from Hindutva. Hindutva is much political,
right?
And things like that. It is not concerned with the devotion of people and things like that. But Hindutva is more political, and it is much more related to nationalistic movements, which were part of history, where Hitler was a nationalist as such, and many such people who perpetrated great violence in society. So Hindutva as such can be related to something like that. So we want to expose this kind of ideology, a fascist ideology called Hindutva. So we can come up with a website to expose, the Hindutva as such.
Okay, yeah, that's fair. And so let's keep talking about these things, and let's keep, feel free to ask questions as a response to the video, and like our videos if you like it, and also subscribe to our channel if you like it, and hit the bell button. And also please feel free to write comments on the video. And I've been receiving a lot of appreciation and questions also from our friends from US and our friends from Europe. Thank you so much for doing so. And at the end, I would just like to give you a my understanding of what being in West you should do is, I think, you know, people like Rajiv Malhotra have carried this propaganda against Christianity and against Islam and against everything, including Hinduism, to promote their ideology of Hindutva, which is different from Hinduism, which is different from Indianness. And they have been raising your money, my brothers, my sisters, to break my country. So be careful in promoting, be careful in giving money to such goons or such international mafia who is willing to break my country, who is struggling hard to break my country. I would like to have your support with us. And we don't need any financial support, but we just need your support in prayers. We just need your support in, working with us in terms of identifying people such as Rajiv Malhotra, who are funding universities to stop the real scholarship and fund only those who like to speak or who like to parrot the way they want the world to know what Hindutva is. Anyways, keep watching our shows. Thank you so much.